Actually, they invited my wife to sing, and I was just along for the ride. Well, it's really a blessing to be here to share the message with you this morning. I am a United Methodist. My mom, of course, is a devout a Baptist, and she said she was sure there was a God when I became a Christian, and she was sure there was a Satan when I became a Methodist. So, but I am surely glad to be here this morning. Now, I sometimes we forget that we make assumptions that everybody understands what this uniform is. For those of you who don't know, this is an Army uniform. It's on its way out, actually. They're changing it again. This is the second iteration for me. When I came in the Army, they were greens. And they switched to this they switched to it 2 months after I bought my new, brand new green uniform so that I could spend another $800 and buy this uniform instead. I'm sure somebody was happy about that and made some money off of that. But I am so glad to be here today, and I appreciate all the well wishes from my dad. I'm sure you can't see any resemblance between me and dad. I might talk a little less, but that's all right. So our scripture lesson this morning is from 1 Peter 1, 17 through 21. Since you call on a Father who judges each person's work impartially, live out your time as foreigners here in reverent fear. For you know that it was not the perishable things such as silver and gold that were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. He was chosen before the creation of the world, but it was revealed in these last times for your sake. Through him you believe in God, who raised him from the dead and glorified him, so that your faith and hope are in God. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of our scripture this morning. So I'm a big movie goer. I like to go to movies, and one of my favorite movies is Shawshank Redemption. I don't know if you've ever seen that movie. I love that movie. But as you watch that movie, you kind of get the idea of what it might be like to spend the rest of your life behind bars. You're forever watched. You hardly have any time to ever be alone, except the rare instance where you might be in an individual cell at the prison there, or to yourself in the evenings. Even the lights, you don't have a choice to turn on and off the lights. They turn them on in the morning and they turn them off in the evening. You've got plenty of time to think. Prisoners have a difficult time sleeping, and life becomes routine, and you are told when to get up. You're told when to lie down. You're told when to eat, whether you want to eat or not, whether you're hungry or not. You're told when to go to the bathroom, when to take a shower. And you're told when you can go out and when you can come in. And even when you go out, you're surrounded by walls, and there may or may not be some scenic view that you can see. Now, hopefully, when you're a prisoner, you make a few friends that will protect you from other groups from harm. You never know. Now, I suppose one is kind of like an animal in prison, hyper-vigilant, always looking around, always looking over your shoulder, wondering what might be coming. Now, I don't know how many of you have animals or have had animals, but have you ever gone and to pick your animal up after they've been at the vet's for a while, or like we're going to go back and pick up our two little dogs next week, and how excited they are to get out and to be there with you. It's freedom. Every living thing yearns for freedom. We all want freedom. Yet I believe that there are prisoners who are behind bars in lifetime sentences that experience more freedom than many of us. You see, freedom is a state of mind. There are people so frozen by all kinds of fear, and they can't experience freedom. There are people who are prisoners to many things. Maybe it's an addiction such as alcohol or cocaine, or maybe it's simply reckless relationships. Maybe it's they're prisoners to the need to constantly receive approval from other people. Maybe it's the fear that something bad, the constant idea that something bad is about to happen, so they never take any risks in their lives. There are people who can't leave their houses literally, because they're afraid and they would have a panic attack if they left their house. They're prisoners of their own homes. Now, there are older children who still are living with their parents, because to leave them would be leaving a codependent relationship. They rely on one another and they can't cope on their own. They are afraid. They live in fear. We have more prisons built in our minds than could ever be built by mortar and by brick. Freedom is a state of mind. You can visit any prison and find people who experience more freedom than people who are physically free to come and go as they desire. Now, I'm thinking, for instance, of Nelson Mandela. Would anyone have ever predicted that this man, who spent 20 years in prison, would one day be the president of the very country in which he was imprisoned? But there was freedom in Mandela's soul, and the prison bars could not defeat that freedom. And I'm thinking also, of course, of Joseph, the Old Testament son of Jacob. When he was sold into slavery, would anyone have thought that he would ever become a trusted advisor to the king of Egypt? Joseph even spent some time in prisons of Egypt before he was set free. He said to his brothers later, "What you meant for evil, God meant for good." We dare not take our freedom for granted. That's a very dangerous thing to do. What if, for instance, in the 1930s and 40s, the police came to our homes and loaded us into trucks and took us away simply because of our religious preference? Of course, during World War II, it was because you were Jewish that they did that. But what if we suddenly were taken over by a foreign government and loaded into trucks and taken to prison because we were Americans? Think about that for a minute. If that happened, wouldn't our worries and our priorities change? The things we really think about, wouldn't those things change? Suddenly, we'd worry more about survival instead of what the next car we might have, or how long our car would run, or what it needs. We'd wonder where our next meal was coming from instead of complaining about our choices of food at the grocery store, or how far we had to walk to get into the door at the grocery store. And we would hold our families much closer, hoping that they wouldn't split us up and send us to different places. Instead of bickering and arguing with one another, sometimes not even speaking to our brothers and sisters and our children for days and for months and for years because of our pride. We would put priorities in order. Reality would hit us between the eyes, and we would long for those earlier days. We would pray, "Oh Lord, just set us free, and I'll change my ways. Give me another chance to live, and I'll really live my life to the fullest." Viktor Frankl knew the tragedy of the Holocaust. He was a prominent Jewish physician who was kept alive because of his medical abilities, because of his ability as a doctor. Still, he was persecuted, and several times, if you read any of his books, you'll find that he had near-death experiences. And he was separated from his family, and many of his family were put into concentration camps and killed. But he survived. In the book he wrote, Man's Search for Meaning, it's one of the books he chronicles his experience that he believes kept him alive. And he states, I'm going to read this to you now. "I remember two cases of would-be suicides, which bore striking similarities to each other. Both men had talked of their intentions to commit suicide. Both used a typical argument. They had nothing to expect from life. In both cases, it was a question of getting them to realize that life still had something to expect from them. Something in the future was expected of them. And we found, in fact, that for one, there was a child whom he adored and was waiting for him in a foreign country. And for the other, it was a thing, not a person. This man was a scientist, and he'd written a series of books which still needed to be finished. His work could not be done by anyone else, any more than any other person could take the place of the father's child's affection. This uniqueness and singleness which distinguished each individual and gives a meaning to his existence has a bearing on creative work as much as it does on human love. A man who becomes conscious of his responsibilities he bears to human beings who affectionately wait for him or unfinished work will never be able to throw their life away. He knows the why for his existence and how he will be able to bear almost anything now. In a concentration camp, every possible thing was done. They conspired to make prisoners lose hold of their reality. All the familiar goals in life were snatched away. What alone remains is the last of human freedoms, the ability to choose one's attitude in a given set of circumstances. These prisoners in these camps, they were average men and they were average women. But some, at least, by choosing to be worthy of suffering, proved man's capacity to rise above their outward fate. So, what is freedom really about? Who of us is really free? Does our sense of freedom rely on our circumstances, which, by the way, we can't control our circumstances, or does it rely on something else? As the old alcoholic had it right when he said, "Let go and let God." I'm sure you've heard that saying before. Some of us are prisoners because we cannot let go. Whatever the circumstances, we must be in control. You've met those people that always have to be in control of everything that's going on. And it's frustrating because it's impossible to always be in control. We live in a society where we are not free. At least not, we don't feel free, I think is a better way to put it. We feel driven, and we drive ourselves into a state of anxiety because we can't let it go. And I'm guilty of that as anybody. I get all wrapped up in what's going on and try to change things. I get tense. If you know my dad, I'm like my dad. You understand that. We tense up and we grind our teeth over things we cannot control. And this brings us to the central truth of today's lesson. Ultimate freedom comes from Christ. That's our ultimate freedom. The early churches in Rome probably included three kinds of prisoners in their memberships. There were slaves, there were free men, and there were freed men. There's a difference there. There were various reasons why someone might be a slave. Some were sold into slavery as children by their parents at birth. Some sold themselves into slavery to pay off a debt. And then some were taken captive in war. And after a certain number of years in slavery or after paying a certain price, the slave would then usually be set free. A freedman was a former slave who had bought or worked his way out of slavery. Now, in some instances, someone else could buy the slave and grant his or her freedom. They could do that. This paying the price to buy someone out of slavery was in the Greek was called latroon. In our lesson from 1 Peter, when the writer says that Christ gave his life as a ransom, the actual word there that was used was latroon, which is a form of latroon. The writer is saying that Christ has paid the price to set us free. Amen. And yet, some of us are still slaves. Slaves to fear. Some of us are still slaves to worry. And some of us are still slaves to sin. So here are the words of the Master this morning. Bring me your heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Why are you anxious? Look at the birds of the air. If God cares for them, how much more does he care for you? Now let not your hearts be troubled. I have prepared a place for you, that where I am, you may also be also. Christ came that we might have freedom. So I'll listen to the words from our text again. For you know that it's not with perishable things, such as silver and gold, that you are redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your forefathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, the Lamb without blemish or defect. Through him you believed in God, who raised him from the dead and glorified him, and so your faith and hope are in God. Our hope is in God, and in that hope is freedom beyond measure. No matter what your outside circumstances are, you can be free in your heart and your spirit. It's the freedom of the heart to be in peace, to be at peace with God, And that's how we know a freedom that the world cannot know. And the world cannot take that freedom away from us.
Amen.
Jesus could be at peace on the cross. Paul could be at peace in prison. Because they knew who held the keys to unlock the prison in life or in death. You see, their hope was in God, and thus they were free. And we too, who have a relationship with a living God, are free. So thanks this morning, thanks be to God for our freedom today, for tomorrow, and forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Our closing hymn this morning. God bless America. Share the message, and now hear the benediction. May the love, the joy, and the peace of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen. Go in peace. Have a wonderful day and a wonderful week. God bless.
Thank you.